Girl Gaze brings four women photographers, two from India and two from the UK, together on a single platform to talk about themes and issues surrounding women, but definitely not a feminist approach that the exhibition has. The photographers were given the freedom to choose their stance, choose their philosophy of work as part of the exhibition, which is the endeavor of the creative black country in UK and the Punjab Lalit Kala Academy. So as part of the exhibition here, which has opened first in Chandigarh, the Girl Gaze, we have Andrea Fernandes, who has been part of the project. And Andrea is from Mumbai, is a trained photographer, and is part of the project. So we will speak to Andrea about her experience and her work here in Girl Gaze. Welcome to Punjab Lalit Kala Academy.
Thank you.
So tell us a little, of course, Andrea, you studied in the UK?
I studied in the UK.
Okay, and you did, you graduated?
I did my master's degree there.
In photography?
In photographic studies, yeah. Okay. So photographic theory. Yeah.
Photographic theory?
Theory,
okay.
Yeah.
So tell us a little about your study, and then how has it translated into work, and a little about yourself.
Okay. I started working earlier because I wanted to apply for this master's thing, but you could only apply if you had either done a bachelor's degree in photography or if you had 3 years work experience. So I worked before.
Okay.
I worked as a fashion photographer actually, and then I went to get this degree. And I told you it was a photographic theory degree, so I started doing more of my own work and started working on like my own private practice and my personal practice. And yeah, I haven't done very much fashion since then, so I'm just kind of, that's when it started. I think that was 2009. Yeah.
Okay. And so when did you pass out?
In 2010.
10. Yeah. Okay. So what has your work been since then? I mean, you say you don't do fashion anymore.
Mm.
So where has...
I'd like to, in my own way though.
Okay.
I was focusing a lot on sexuality and gender initially, and until quite recently, and I think now it's kind of diversified, like with this project, because I had the chance to for really long. I think it's diversified into becoming even more personal and even maybe philosophical rather than documentary as much.
Hmm. So what is your style of photography when we talk about sexuality and gender? Do you do only images, because some of the photographers here have also used installations and video art and performance? So tell us a little about your technique and style of photography.
I mean, it depends on whatever the project needs, of course, but I do still photography. I use a lot of text in my work. So there's in the one over here also, it's photographs and texts. But it really depends. I mean, for one of the most recent projects that I did, we made a book for it, but then if it needs an exhibition, then it has to go. I mean, it depends really on the work, but it's usually still images and photographs. And then the technique and everything just depends on what the work needs, and the process dictates it. Like even this project started off as, it was all meant to be, you asked me about my old project, sorry, I'll tell you about that. So I usually do stage photographs. I like to speak to women and interview them for my previous work. And I usually find that people talk to me a lot more if I'm not going to actually photograph them.
True.
So I do interviews, and I use all of this material, usually in the form of text in some way or the other, and then I stage the photograph. So I either stage it with people, or I just create like mise-en-scenes or like still lifes and things like this. That was my idea for this project also, but it changed a lot. I usually shoot also only for personal work. I shoot analog.
Okay.
But this time it's all digital.
Okay.
I changed, so it really depends. Because I'm shooting analog, I usually have shorter bodies of work, and this one, I hope you come see it at some point.
Yes, I did see it.
Oh, you saw
it?
Okay,
yes.
cool. So, you know, it has like 1,000 images or something, and it's still running, and so it had to be digital. So whatever works, really.
True.
Yeah.
So tell us a little about Girl Gaze, and how did it happen, and what was your process as a young photographer?
How it started was Iona spoke to me a few years ago. I think she was doing her, Iona's a curator. She was doing her master's degree, I think, herself. And she spoke to me regarding one of the projects I had done so she could write about it. And I think so that's how she knew I worked with women. And
So women are an essential part of your work?
I think for many years, just because I think I get it. I mean, I would also like to make work with men, but I just haven't found anything that I'm so interested in yet. So it's not something that I specifically do, but yeah, it was for many years something that all my work revolved around. And I think that's the connection. That's how I got onto this project.
When you got this project, what was your first thought? Because girl gaze, that was the, were you given a premise or were you given a brief or no, it was your own creative impulse?
Yeah, I think the cool thing was that it was really open because the brief was very simple. It was just that we had to go to these places.
Right.
We had to meet Punjabi women and we had to produce the work at the 31st of January. That was it. And that everything else was up to us. So that was really good.
That meant a lot of freedom.
Which is also sometimes a bit scary. Because first I was like, oh, wow, I can do anything I want. And they were like, yeah, you're just being chosen for this because we like what you do. So do whatever you want. And then as soon as that comes onto you, then you start feeling that responsibility. Yes. Like who? And I had so many existentialist crises during this work because every time I reached a point where I was like, who am I? What do I want to say? So I guess it was a process of answering that question more than anything else.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So what was the format that you had for this exhibition? Talk a little about the more you cry, the more you laugh.
You laugh as much as you cry.
As much as you cry.
I heard that sentence, like this phrase, really early on when I started. And I remember when I was, this lady was saying something and she said this saying. And I usually often doodle and stuff. And then I was doodling after that again and again because this phrase kept playing. And I was drawing this graph, which said like Hasna and Rona. And I was drawing this like equal, like you laugh as much as you cry. So this was what I was doing. And I kept thinking like there's something off with this. And I mean, to make like the long story short, by the end of the project, I realized that the graph was wrong. Because, and even the phrase, I wasn't understanding it correctly because I was thinking it in a very literal sense. Because sometimes when you laugh too much or like as a girl or something, sometimes literally you cry, exactly, you do that. And sometimes people will also say things like, don't laugh so much because something bad will happen now. Yeah. You know, like nazar lag jayegi or something like this.
Right.
So I kept thinking it was more that. But as the project progressed, I started thinking about it more and more. And it just stayed with me. I realized it was more about like time. So you laugh as much as you cry, but also something that's happening now, which is maybe super tragic or sad or upsetting. When I look at it 5 years from now, it may not seem bad at all.
Yes. And you can laugh about it.
Yeah, and you can laugh about it. And this thing keeps changing over time.
Yes.
So it became more about that. So I made a new graph now. So it's like a line which is like laughter and has rona niche, and in the middle there's time, and uske upar this just kind of changes. So that was like the title of the work and how it came about. I finally figured it out.
Okay. So what was the process? Because you had to be in the UK and in India and two contrasting ambiences and cultural context. So what was in your mind? How were you going to translate into photography?
I think the beginning was pretty, I started doing research as I normally do, because I come from that background, you know, I come from an academic background. I was just like, chalo, I have to do research on migration and Punjab and Punjabis and women and all of that. So I started very much from there and from news stories and all of this. But I think because I spent so much time there that after a while, these stories they weren't holding everyone together.
Right.
So of course, everyone had stories of migration, partition, arranged marriages, this kind of, you know, all of this stuff, everyone had some story or the other, whether good or bad. But then I realized that that was exactly it, that everyone had these stories and everyone had some either good or bad stories about it. And depending also on this time thing, they would remember it in a good way or a bad way, you know. So this, because of that, I realized that it wasn't really fixed and there was nothing holding this community together. And neither in the UK or here or to get connecting them, because of course the people in the UK had this idea of Punjab. Yes. The people in Punjab had no idea what the black country is. And there was a lot of nostalgia there. And, you know, there was so much mixture that the work became like that, you know, that each person I met kind of changed the work. Because they were like, nee, nee, aise nahi hota. Like, I remember when I came to Chandigarh, I met quite a few women. There's actually a quote, I think, in the exhibition also, where this woman I was talking to, quite a young girl actually, she was like, why would I leave Chandigarh? She's like, I'm rich and I'm rich in Chandigarh. And then I thought, you know, it just goes so much against this whole idea that everyone just wants to leave and go abroad.
Right.
But there's like tons of people who are
no. Absolutely. Yeah.
So there was always somebody who would match the stereotype, of course, because it comes from somewhere. And then someone who would just be like completely the opposite. So there's always a spectrum. So the whole work is like, this is everyone. There's no like Punjabi or...
Right, interesting. And tell me, which part of Punjab did you visit?
So first I came to Chandigarh, where I was told, so it's good that you're in Chandigarh, but Chandigarh is not in Punjab. So down the road,
right.
I moved. I went to Jalandhar, I went to Patiala, Amritsar, Ludhiana, I think that was it. But I also went road tripping, so that was fun, because I was taking these buses, which are so fun bus.
Yes, love it. And you stop after every few meters.
Yeah, and you can just stop when you see something.
And,
then you pay another like 100 rupees and then you can go. That's great.
Okay. So,
so that's what I did.
It became like a...
Yeah, because I had that time. Yeah.
And when it came to finally putting it all together, what were the challenges and did you have to really contextualize a lot or did you, and did you feel at the end of it that you left out quite a bit or was it a satisfying process?
I would say I've still, like the exhibition, I think as it's going on, it's going to keep getting bigger because like in the end, I think around 1300, I finalized on this because I usually have 16 or 18, you know, something like
because
this.
Because you were in the analog,
And this time I've just had so many and I didn't want to take out anything. I almost didn't have an edit because I was like, no, I want everything. Everything is important and everything is connected to something. Sometimes it could be something really random, but I was like, no, I need to have this woman because she told me this story. And the same other woman somewhere else told me the story and they were both in that kind of like same location.
Okay.
So like they both need to be there. And because I couldn't take out anyone from the work, I couldn't take out any place and everything had some meaning. And also they had several meanings because things would overlap not only. So somebody would tell me a story with several features, but then it would also be connected to some other story that I'd heard. And so because I have portraits and I have these symbols from the stories, I have scenes and I have landscapes. And the only way, and I wanted to show it in a way, so initially I was going to put 1300 like little photographs on the wall, but I also needed it to move because I was like, I want to show that this is connected to this, but this is also connected to this.
Right.
And this is, you know, so that's why in the end I've done this projection mapping where finally everything moves and everything can actually connect with each other. So of course I never imagined it. I didn't know it was possible. It was just something in my head that I imagined because I was like, I wish I could show this photograph with three photographs, then it would change, then something else would happen, then the story would come up. And yeah, it actually happened somehow.
And it's come out together beautifully.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm happy.
You can, it's almost like a moving picture. So
yeah, I think it's quite, I think it really I had this idea and I needed to manifest it, and I think this is that. This is the manifestation of this year. Just like finally it's out of my head.
Yes.
It's the whole world that I'd imagined in both of these places had combined.
Come together.
Now
so, yes.
This is it.
Right. But do you hope to do something else with it? Is it?
Yeah. Mm. I would like
such
to
such a
do
large
it.
Body of work.
Yeah. I think for me this, like initially this was the end goal, but I think now it's the first step.
Yeah.
So I think it's like the experiment, because now that, because I had to learn all these new software and figure out all of that stuff. And now that I have a good hang of it, I think I'd like to do
Could
it much bigger. Yeah.
New starting
yeah,
point
yeah.
for you. So what are you working on these days? Something else?
Just, I think I've just been
immersed.
Right. Yes, right. And I'm going to stay in it for a bit, I think.
And how important are exhibitions like these, which bring together different people from different cultures and backgrounds? How important are these in today's time?
I think it's really important, just because we have so many, we have pictures everywhere.
Right.
But I think people always kind of dismiss it as something
yes.
like illustrative or something fun. But now and that's why I think exhibitions are fun, and also the need to take out that thing that elitism of it, that only, you know, like this private view and some people come and,
right.
you know, all of that. Just because I would really like for everyone to come, and also that's also one of the reasons that very early on with this work, I was quite sure that I needed it to, because I was having conversations with just anyone and everyone,
yes.
because the only thing was like, you're Punjabi, let's talk.
Right.
And so I wanted every single person that I talked to, just like I could take something from their story. I was like, they should be able to get something. So I think that, I hope that happens. I mean, I would like there to have been a little bit more Gurmukhi script in there, I think it's just important, because I think that people should be able to spend time with it, not be scared of work, because
Absolutely.
There's so much that we can talk about if we just realize that actually we're speaking the same language.
Mm-hmm.
It's just sometimes we artists tend to use a little bit of extra jargon and make it a bit scary, so I just try to keep it
yes.
as easy as possible.
Simple.
Yeah.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank
you.
Nice to speak
and lots
to you
of luck.
Too. Yeah.